Daughter of the East, Benazir Bhutto, an autobiography. Oppressed population go through three stages during the course of oppression: anger, fear and apathy. For anger and fear, Pakistan did not have to look beyond Ziaul Haq. For apathy, they did not have to look beyond Benazir Bhutto. Benazir Bhutto was the firstborn of the allied Bhutto family. She went to Redcliffe and later to Oxford. She was the first woman president of the Oxford Union. Benazir Bhutto was young, 23, when her father was murdered by Zia, was kept in prison by Zia for several years. She provided leadership to PPP, her political party. It is evident that Benazir Bhutto belongs to an elite amongst the various Pakistani elites. Benazir said, "Democracy is the best revenge." This book is about Benazir's adoring father, former Prime Minister Zulfiqar Ali Bhutto, and his adoring daughter who was living on the dreams and destiny of her father. The author often acknowledged the influence of her father's example and stories. She says, "My father's imprint on me, however, keeps me going, endurance." The book also captures the significant contribution of Benazir's mother, who continued to fight with courage and endurance after her husband was assassinated. This book is about Pakistan and the fight for a sustained democracy in the period of time in which Bhutto writes, peace and democracy appeared so fleeting and fragile, yet the securing of democracy is the major motivation for Benazir Bhutto. Benazir, the first woman in her family to study abroad, was graduated from Harvard University at 20. As an undergraduate, she sat behind her father in heated United Nations. A friend told Benazir Bhutto, "What is not recorded is not remembered." That is the reason she wrote this biography. My father had told before going to Harvard University in 1969, "You are going far away to America." He has told me as we stood among the graves of our forefather, "You will see many things that amaze you and travel to places you have never heard of. But remember, whatever happens to you, you will ultimately return here. Your place is here. Your roots are here. The dust and mud and heat of Larkana are in your bones. And it is here that you will be buried." Islam, in fact, had been quite progressive towards women from its inception. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, had forbidden that killing of female infants, common among the Arabs of the time, and called for education for women and their rights to inherit long before these privileges were granted to them in the West. Though my father was being held in solitary confinement, my father led me to believe that his major concern continued to be my education. My father told me, "You have all the books you need. Read about Napoleon Bonaparte, the most complete man of modern history. Read about the American Revolution and about Abraham Lincoln. Read 10 Days That Shook the World by John Reed. Read about Bismarck and Lenin, Ataturk and Mao. Read the history of India from ancient times. And above all, read the history of Islam." But he was adamant that I go to Oxford. 4 years in one place is more than enough, he wrote to me. "If you stay longer in America, you will begin to put down roots there. It's time for you to move on." My brothers, sister, and I had all flown home separately. Shah from school in Switzerland, Sanam from Harvard, Mir and I from Oxford. Our parents did not permit us to travel together for fear of an accident. "Thanks God you have completed your education and are home," my father had greeted me just 10 days ago. "Now you can help me." My father's spirit remained high, as did his sense of humor. A journalist phoned today and asked me how I was passing the time. My father replied. I told him I was reading a lot of Napoleon to learn how he had kept his journals in line when I could not control mine. In a country like Pakistan, where literacy rates are low, rumor and bazaar gossip often substitute for the truth. You are being careless, my father said to me sharply. You are not in the democracy of the West now. You are home under martial law. Papa said while he ate, one of the people leaders asked me for money today so he could flee. Go if you like, I told him. But I am not a rat who runs. I am going to stay here and face Zia. The refugees and the Soviet Union troops on our doors, which result in a foreign aid for Zia, eventually making Pakistan the third largest recipient of US aid after Israel and Egypt. The Soviet invasion of Afghanistan became known in Pakistan as Christmas present to Zia, and my mother and I remain incarcerated at Al-Murtaza. My father, who happened to be passing by the inner steel wall on the way to a meeting with his lawyers, overheard Shah arguing with the jailer. You are my son, don't ask them for any favors. My father called out loudly to my brother, go for your studies and work hard. Make me proud of you. My father knew that you can imprison a man but not an idea. You can exile a man but not an idea. You can kill a man but not an idea. Zia knew he was in a corner. He closed down universities all over Pakistan and banned meetings of more than 5 people. Under Zia, all had been reversed. Once more, Sindh was being discriminated against. The state held some of the best land in Sindh. Under Zia, it was parceled out to army officers instead of the landless farmer. The Sindhis who had risen to management position in industry were being replaced with retired army officers. Despite the fact that 65% of the country revenue came from the Sindh port of Karachi, little of the revenue found its way back into the province. Regarding Asif Ali Zardari, she wrote in a book, another mutual friend used an Urdu saying to describe Asif Ali Zardari, strong willed and loyalty. He is a friend of friend and an enemy's enemy, he told me. The description reminded me of my brother and was appealing. For years, people had interpreted my political opposition to Zia as a platform for avenging my father's murder. But that was not the case. You can't be fueled by bitterness. It can eat you up, but it cannot drive you. The task and my motivation remained the same, to return Pakistan to a democracy through fair and impartial election. In 1986, she decided to return courageously to Pakistan when Zia was in rule. Despite military rule and big brothers watching, people gave her a welcome that no political leader could ever rival. She continued to whip up her agenda for bringing democracy back to Pakistan for the next 2 years. 1988 proved to be the turning point for Pakistan and Bhutto. Zia's role for Pakistan to be a frontline state in the war against communism proved to be temporary. Zia's role for Pakistan to be a frontline state in Wahhabi Islam proved to be permanent. Zia died in an accident. Benazir Bhutto became the first woman PM of Pakistan when she was just 35 years old. Until this time, her life is a story that inspires. After becoming Prime Minister, hers is a story of lost opportunities. She did not use her power base to enshrine democracy and was comfortable securing a position of power in existing autocratic framework. This allowed Ghulam Isaak Khan to dismiss her once and Farooq Lughari to dismiss her again. She did not ensure her husband Asif Ali Zardari was above suspicion. Pakistan government had detained her husband in prison for more than 6 years on 90 charges of corruption, though it has not secured conviction in even one case. Benazir Bhutto was a controversial figure. She was often criticized as being politically inexperienced and corrupt. Murtaza focused much of his criticism on Bhutto's husband Zardari, whom he blamed of being responsible for government corruption. He hung a picture of Zardari up in the guest toilet of his house as an act of disrespect to his brother-in-law. It is reported that in one incident, Murtaza invited Zardari to his house only to have pinned down by bodyguards and half his mustache forcibly shaved off. Not long after, on 20th September 1996, Murtaza was ambushed by police near Karachi. They opened fire, killing him and 7 others. After Bhutto hinted that President Lughari had been involved in her brother's death, relations between the two broke down. Zardari tried to flee to Dubai but was arrested in Lahore, charged with money laundering and involvement in Murtaza's murder. He remained in prison until 2004. Benazir Bhutto was an economist by profession. Therefore, during her term as Prime Minister, she herself took charge of the Ministry of Finance. Bhutto sought to improve the country's economy, which was declining as time was passing. Soon after the collapse of the Soviet Union, Benazir attempted to privatize major industries that was nationalized in the 1970s. In the final years of Bhutto's life, she and her husband lived apart. According to Allen, she would have been aware that a divorce or a public separation would have resulted in the end of her political career in Pakistan due to social stigma around the subject.